The first voice recording was made in 1860. It was a 10-second fragment of the French folk song Eau Claire de la Lune recorded by inventor Edward Leon Scott de Martinville. But who will make the final voice recording and when? What will it be? Who will hear it? He walked out in the gray light and stood and he saw for a brief moment the absolute truth of the world. The cold relentless circling of the intestate earth. Darkness implacable. The blind dogs of the sun in their running. The crushing black vacuum of the universe. And somewhere 200 animals trembling like ground foxes in their cover. Borrowed time and borrowed world and borrowed eyes with which to sorrow it.
And lo, for the earth was empty of form, and void, and darkness was all over the face of the deep, and we said, look at that fucker dance.
Okay, welcome to Heat Death of the Universe, your number one transdermal podcast patch for all your analgesic needs. We come to you from Seoul, South Korea at 11:58 a.m. It's June 11th, 2021, stamped for posterity. Today is our third episode on Empire of Pain. It's our first edition of the book club, Heat Death of the Universe book club. And yeah, we're going to finish up talking about this book.
We have our knitting needles ready. Ready to knit and talk. Josh is
Is that what happens at book club?
I'm knitting a scarf. Yeah, I think so. You go to the book club, you discuss the book, and you knit. You've never been to a book club?
I have been in a book club. We didn't do any knitting. We were like...
Well, we're doing knitting now. Don't lie.
Before now.
Right.
In my younger days, I was in a book club once with some friends.
And I learned how to knit in high school.
Most of those book clubs just ended in drunken arguments. Because, yeah, we'd be drinking heavily while talking about whatever. Somebody chose Ender's Game for that book club. I did not like that book.
I loved that book when I was 12.
I think I read like half of it. I was like, I don't know, it just seemed like most of it was just about like kids being naked. But that's probably a horrible generalization.
Maybe
I think
you're
I just
too old.
I found out later that that author is a real piece of shit.
Yeah, did you know while reading?
No, I didn't, but I still didn't really like the book.
I knew nothing about the author when I read it.
But I remember like my friend like some people
See, I really liked it when I was a kid, but I read it pretty young.
Yeah, you read
it
as a kid.
It's really just about forcing kids into war, kids who don't want to be in war. That's the premise of the book.
Yeah, there's like some obvious like parallels you could draw between war. And I think at the time I was doing this book club was like probably like 2005. So like right in the middle of the horror of Iraq War Part 2.
Yeah.
And
it's young adult literature. It's supposed to be for, like, I think 13 to 16 year olds.
Yeah.
It's not written for adults, but some adults truly love young adult literature and only read things like Harry Potter for the rest of their life.
They're weird, but whatever.
They are weird. and I enjoy Harry Potter. And sadly also know the author is a shithead.
Well, as far as we know, the author of Empire of Pain, Patrick Radden Keefe, is not a shithead.
He seems, and also not work on young adult literature.
No. Seems like a good guy from what I can tell.
I'd read his young adult literature if he made some.
About the opioid crisis?
Yeah, about a 15-year-old getting addicted to opioids and recovering.
Does it come with a coloring book as well? Yeah. Actually, a graphic novel about this wouldn't be bad. Just really make the Sacklers look as stupid as they come across in words. Anyway.
The current generation of Sacklers seem incredibly dense.
Yeah, good place to start. So we're on book three. There are books within this book. It's split into three. This is the third and final one called Legacy. We got chapters 21 to 29 here and an afterword that we read for this. And so the first chapter here, Turks, it does kind of go into the third generation of Sacklers, I guess. So
whenever they were describing Mortimer, for some reason I couldn't help but think of Jared Kushner. Did they even make like a comparison between the two? For some reason he just...
No, but they do mention in passing Ivanka Trump somewhere soon in this last third of the book. Mortimer. Wait, you thought of Kushner, not like Don Jr.?
I don't know why I thought of Kushner. I did.
You think he's more of a son to Trump? I mean,
Kushner's also from one of those rich families. I don't remember what his family did, but he's from that type.
Oh, I thought you were going off the junior angle, but
no, I just the way they describe Mortimer is that he's kind of just like, I mean, he's involved, he has a position of power, but he seems like he doesn't really know what's going on.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know how much he even was involved in the company. But, like, so the chapter is called Turks because it's in reference to, like, these extremely exclusive areas in the Caribbean where the Sacklers have, like, a giant compound of villas, just, like, this opulent, like, ridiculous place.
Island for rich people to go play, a rich person playground, so to speak. Like, I think that it says that Brad Pitt occasionally vacations there and other famous celebrities.
Yeah, it's over the...
And it's not so far from the Philippines, and sometimes Filipinos will try to swim there to live a slightly better life.
No.
Did I get that wrong?
The Caribbean is on the other side of the earth from the Philippines.
Oh, right. What was I talking... There was that whole section where it's talking
Haiti.
About dead bodies.
Haiti.
My bad.
No, you're confusing. They mentioned that a lot of the majority of the staff were Filipino immigrants.
I'm fucking bad at geography. We live in a big world.
And names and faces and so on.
I get lost on my own street.
I was going to say, man, swimming from the Philippines to the Caribbean, that's a hell of a tall order.
Good point.
The author's just kind of describing like just how sort of removed from reality these people are. And it's describing like also the kind of even more removed from reality sense of the third generation of Sacklers, of which there is, to recap, like the main Sacklers that started like this the dynasty were these three brothers, Arthur, who in this point in the story is long dead. He was the patriarch. And then there was Mortimer, And then there was Raymond. And so Mortimer begat Mortimer Jr., who's the focus of the first like part of this chapter. And he just talks about how he had like a real typical, you know, rich kid life. He went to like the best private high schools. He went to Harvard.
Had no friends at those high schools. They made clear about that.
I don't remember that part, but that makes sense.
Well, no, basically what it said was he went to a very like, I mean, a high school for rich kids, and the rich kids didn't like him because of how fucking rich
he was. Oh, right, right. He was too much of a yuppie for the rich of the richest of the rich.
I've seen this happen. So like, which obviously when I worked at Samyuk, which is obviously doesn't have kids at this level of richness, but it's like a school for rich kids in Korea. And I did have one kid who was obviously more rich than like all the surgeon and like building owner kids who was kind of ostracized for it. It was weird. Weird to see.
Yeah. I mean, but it kind of makes sense.
But he also would make fun of kids for their parents just being doctors.
See, that's probably the bigger part of it is they're just assholes to everybody.
Yeah.
If they were nice, I'm sure they would be welcomed into the fold.
Oh, your dad's poor. He's just a doctor.
Some of the details of this compound were like things like if the sand on the beach was too hot for their precious feet, they would like spray it down with cold water.
That's horrible. I usually hire people. When I go to the beach, I hire like a crew of people to go and spray the beach down with water or whatever I'm walking around because I just don't want to be bothered with
just
the slops.
To walk in front of you spraying as you go.
You don't do that? I thought that was like normal for everyone.
No, you gotta hook me up with your sand spraying guy.
Work crew.
Yeah. And then like you were in a roundabout way mentioning Haiti is not too far. I mean, a few hundred miles, but relatively not too far away from this place. And sometimes the bodies of people who've, you know, attempted and failed to flee Haiti would wash up on the shore, and the staff would make sure to remove these unsightly corpses. So the rich people didn't have to see them. It's like literally like insulating them from, yeah, reality. And there's one like other little detail where, so Morty, it said in the book, unlike Udell, which was the family lawyer for the Sacklers for a long time, unlike him, Mortimer Jr., did not use Oxycontin.
And he had some like back problems, so I guess he was into like trying natural healing of all of this stuff.
Yes,
meditation and
acupuncture and massage. But the funny part was when his wife, who I have it right here, when his back pain was so severe that Jacqueline, his wife, who, when it came to the staff, had a reputation as a fearsome taskmaster, ordered a couple of the butlers to accompany Mortimer as he hobbled about, propping him up as, quote, human crutches. Just the term human crutches kind of leapt out to me. I mean,
you've never had a job where you had to carry around a rich guy?
I mean, in a way, it's sort of like, okay, it's not that weird to, like, help somebody walk who's got, like, an injury. But when you call them human crutches, that's just very dehumanizing, obviously.
Yeah, in my head, I know you've never watched. sorry. In my head, I'm just imagining like One Piece. There's these kind of like the rulers of the world are called the Celestial Dragons. They're all like fat fuck rich family. Just terrible rich people that run the world. And they'll occasionally just like take on human slaves because they can do that. And they'll just like have them like ride them like horses or whatever. That's kind of what I imagine. So Mortimer's not using his crutches. He's just riding on their backs as they like crawl on the ground, carrying them places.
I'd believe it. Another description of Mortimer says here, Mortimer is like the TV character version of himself, one former Purdue employee who dealt with him observed. He's the billionaire's son. So he's just like kind of a caricature. Like, he doesn't have much going on upstairs, so to speak. Like, I think there's another description that says it even better. As one person who knew Mortimer socially put it, I think for him, most of the time, he's just saying, wow, we're really rich. It's fucking cool. I don't really want to think that much about the other side of things. So, yeah. That's basically this guy. He's a fail son. He's a fail grandson of, from the first generation of wealth. Because later on it describes him like somehow still blowing through his like insane, you know, allowance, insane amount of money that he got for nothing. Like he didn't even have like a sort of like cover job. You know what I mean? Like he would just go and be like, listen, all I need is another $10 million plus another $10 million like 6 months after that. That's all I'm asking. In other words, like to kind of like to try to cut to the chase here, because there's so much more to talk about. These third generation of Sacklers are generally kind of useless and totally detached and don't feel any sort of familial responsibility for like how, you know, what the Purdue company has done to the world. And somehow they're just even worse than their parents, who were the second generation of wealth, who are already pretty bad. You know, second generation being like Richard Sackler and Jonathan Sackler and Kathy Sackler. It gets a little confusing. Like, there's too many goddamn Sacklers, but
they had like the work ethic. The second generation, the third generation, you got the feeling that
sort of. Richard did, but only because I think Richard's kind of insane.
Well, he was megalomaniac.
That's what I mean. Like, but like, I don't know. It's not like they were like.
I think Kath was a bit too, or Kath wanted to be Richard. Kath wanted to be.
There's a part down the line here too, though, where it talks about what they did, like what they actually did all day with their time, and like with the exception of Richard, who did spend a lot of time. Putting his time and effort into the company, even if it was for totally rotten things. The other ones just, they kind of sat around. They would just like come and go as they pleased. Like they were all like really living the kind of lazy, luxuriant life for the most part.
Yeah.
With the exception of Richard, who was just like really driven by like maximizing profit and leaving a legacy behind and shit like that. But even he, like, I don't know how hard he was really working, to be honest. I think he was just obsessive. Anyway.
He wanted to be the golden boy of the family. He wanted to make dad proud.
He was trying to be, take up the mantle of, you know, his father and his uncles and stuff. I'm just looking at my notes here. Morty equals vacant, dumb, hollow, shallow, just rich and nothing more. So beyond that description, Oxycontin continues to like boom and generate huge profits despite the little setback.
What about the 2007 case?
Yeah, there was the 2007 case in Virginia, which we talked about last week.
I thought Purdue had promised to, like, you know, have tighter regulations, not sell to pill mill doctors, to report to the government if they thought that type of stuff was happening.
They did indeed.
Sure, they're going to do that.
They promised in a totally non-legally binding way, as far as I could tell. Because no, they didn't do any of that. Like, they made like a really limp gesture towards. Like, we're going to be a better, more ethical company. And they just doubled down on everything they'd been doing up until that point. Because why wouldn't they? They got away basically scot-free. Nobody went to jail. Nobody was financially ruined. Like, everyone was unscathed. They lost $600 million, then plus whatever they spent on lawyers, which is like a drop in the bucket for them. This is like a multi-billion dollar company.
Was it in Turks where they start talking about how the family is taking money out too? And like, I mean, I know they talk more about it later, but is that Turks the first place where they talk about how Mortimer is basically getting $360 million a month or something in a stipend from the company?
Maybe. I can't remember exactly.
Like, each of the children are getting a sane amount of money out of the company each month, living expenses. And there's one point, this is maybe later, there's one point where Mortimer's complaining because they have to drop it down to 250, and he's like, oh, how am I going to live on such little money?
Right.
I'm only getting 250 mil this month.
Was that monthly? Damn, that's ridiculous. That's crazy.
Maybe it was
like quarterly or something. But in any case, yeah, like the family members make up like I think the entire board of the company. Or at least the huge majority of it.
Yeah.
And they would just constantly just vote to pay themselves hundreds of millions of dollars. Like that was their that was like the reason they had board meetings was like, hey, well, we got to re-up on our giant amounts of money. And it says in the book too, that they wouldn't just meet like at the headquarters in Connecticut, but they would just meet at like exotic locations just like because they can, you know? It really was reminding me a lot of Succession. And then later in the book, Succession, the TV show, actually gets brought up as like a parallel to like the way that this family behaves, at least like amongst each other, like all the kind of backstabbing and like the factions within the family. But there's a description of Richard here that I just wanted to read because I thought it was... It further nails down like what a fucking dick this guy is. Mm. It's in the Turks chapter. Before I read that, sorry. Other things that happen are there was a board meeting where in the same board meeting, two things were discussed simultaneously. The sales data showed that like their own internal sales data was told to them to indicate clearly abuse and diversion. And like diversion is just like the sort of a technical industry term for when people take the pharmaceuticals and sell them on the street, basically. And that was just like ignored. And then in like the same breath, they announced a brand new incentive sales program. They're like, okay, well, we're being told by like our accounting experts and whatever people who are like closely monitoring all this like granular data about where our prescriptions go and which doctors are prescribing how much, that it's obvious that, these pills are being like sold in like pill mills. And then the next announcement was, okay, sales team, we've got a brand new program to make you push those pills. So yeah, again, that just goes back to the nothing was dissuading them from like just pushing harder than ever to make as much money as possible. And part of that, aside from just that's the way they always operated, was that the patent cliff was like encroaching, getting closer and closer. But like also at this point in the saga, like really big like crime ring style pill mills are starting to emerge, like not just kind of one off rinky dink like one doctor's office, but like these bigger operations where they were like, they would give like homeless people like $25 and like make, I don't know, like just put them into these clinics to like get the pills out. And yeah, there were just like all sorts of ways that the it doesn't specify like what like sort of crime syndicate was doing this, but it was just happening all over the place. You know, one example was in Los Angeles. It just says a crime ring. It's not specific, but they recruited an elderly physician who was in poor health and struggling with debt to set up a phony clinic called Lake Medical. And he began prescribing a great deal of Oxycontin. One week in September, she prescribed 1,500 pills, more than many pharmacies might sell in a whole month. The next month, the number jumped to 11,000 pills, a disproportionate number of Santiago, that's the doctor. Santiago's prescriptions were for 80 milligram Oxycontin pills, the largest available dose. Yeah, so 80s were like the most profitable pills because you could sell them for $80 for one pill.
Yep.
And it says by the end of the year, that doctor had prescribed 73,000 pills. So, and obviously, again, we talked about this last time, I'm pretty sure, but like the company sees this happening. Like they know what's going on. They know.
Yeah, they keep spreadsheets.
This is not just like, oh, that's a little strange. It's like it jumps out at you as like, I mean, there's a part in the book later where like one of the employees of Purdue is just saying like, shouldn't we call the DEA? Like this is like a huge drug ring. We're selling our,
and the company's like, nope.
Yeah, they just remain quiet until the places get busted, and then they go, oh my goodness, we had no idea.
It's like, we just didn't want to let legitimate users, you know, suddenly lose access. It's like the legitimate users will just go to another doctor, or probably aren't going to that doctor in the first place.
Right. And then they would say their kind of same old bullshit things about like, well, we're not in the room with the doctor. We don't know if they're prescribing things in an unprofessional manner. It's like there's no, anyway, we've covered this. But so then Udell, one of the big figures of the book, the big enforcer man, the lawyer who had, and big advocate for the family and for the company. So this is interesting. Part of his, the two other asshole musketeers like took the fall for the company in 2007 and just got like a payout from the company, and they didn't go to jail, anything like that. But they did have to do some sort of community service, or at least he did.
Whatever.
And he did community service specifically with veterans.
Yeah, and he opened a foundation even.
Yeah, do you want to explain that?
I don't remember the foundation's name. Do you remember his name?
The name doesn't matter, but like, what did they do? Like, what did they target these veterans?
They talked about pain management and even made custom pain management literature for the veterans to help them deal with pain of coming back home from war. And it heavily emphasized how Purdue Pharma drugs could help with that.
Yeah, so it was just like a hyper-targeted marketing thing that he was doing, like, even though he's not even employed by the company anymore. But he is probably getting kickbacks for that, though, too. But
oh, I'm sure he was. I think he was always getting money from them.
And then he died. I guess his weight.
They named a library after him. They named a lab after him, right? In the building, Purdue building.
You were right the first time. I think it was a library. Yeah. Okay. But yeah, they made this sort of memorial library for him, and a lot of the sort of newer, younger employees at Purdue, this becomes a theme throughout the rest of the book. There becomes this kind of split between
the old guard and the new guard.
Yeah, the old guard and the new guard, and even the ones who didn't necessarily have an ethical problem with selling Oxycontin and stuff, they still thought it was kind of fucked up that they would make a memorial for this guy who just literally was found guilty in court for all this stuff.
Yeah, it's like maybe they were looking at it as save their own ass things. Like, you know, maybe we shouldn't draw attention that we're breaking the law.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But of course, you know, Sacklers don't care. They're also pretty removed from reality.
I mean, they're basically above the law. I mean, if this book teaches you anything, take it as a parable that all of these assholes live outside of like regular rules.
Yeah. And then they did the Richard, you know, the big brain of the company, as he likes to think of himself, in which he basically acted as, I mean, he was kind of the mastermind behind a lot of this stuff. But
yeah, definitely.
He decides like what they need is a quote loyal CEO that, you know, they just need a puppet that they can completely control, and then they can reap all of the benefits just as board members. Because by this point, Richard Sackler stepped down as the CEO, and the entire, like, none of the Sacklers officially work for Purdue anymore, but they are all on the board.
They're all on the board.
Which means they, I don't, like, the distinction is so stupid because they have more control as board members than anything.
Especially in a privately held company.
Yeah, that's right. This is not a publicly traded company ever. It just remains.
Like a lot of the things the company did would have been a lot different probably had they been publicly traded.
They wouldn't have survived is what I gathered. Like,
because they wouldn't have survived in the form they did.
Yeah. And I'm sure that's the reason why they wanted to keep it in the family, so to speak.
Yeah.
So then there's this in 2010, there's a big like 10-year projection saying that over the next 10 years, if they're aggressive enough in their sales and everything, that each board member, which I believe there were eight of that were family, they would each make $700 million. So they're all real excited about that. They've got, you know, dollar signs in their eyes. In this third of the book, we introduce a couple of interesting key players. McKinsey, the McKinsey is like a management consulting firm.
Consulting firm. They come in and they like help with PR and books and figure out how to make more profit, maximize profit, and how to cut cost. Usually those type of firms will come in and like, you know, do layoffs of people who are being lazy or not really doing anything, which apparently the Purdue Pharma had a lot of those who were just like loyal to the family, but came into work and did absolutely nothing. They were just there because they had always been loyal to the family.
Yeah. When I think of McKinsey nowadays, I think of the fact that Pete Buttigieg worked for them for a while. I'm wondering if he worked for them at the same time, but I don't think he advised Purdue. No, that would probably
advise Purdue.
That would have come out. Like, the sort of infamous thing with him was how he, what was it? Something that doesn't matter.
How he was secretly a CIA agent.
Well, there's that, but there's something about the, they like artificially inflated the price of bread or something. And like I forget exactly what it was, but they basically they're like fixing bread prices. And Buttigieg was asked about it, like in a really straightforward way, and Buttigieg just like, you know, didn't know what to say. And it was, I don't know, it was like a viral thing for a while. But anyway, McKinsey does not have a very good reputation. So,
Although their business is based around making rich people more rich, usually through means that are bad for workers and companies. From what I understand.
Yeah, my notes here just says McKinsey advises evilly. Their whole advice really boiled down to just sell more OxyContin, like sell as much as you can while you can, basically like get it while it's hot. But there's this passage I wanted to read about Richard. In the same chapter here, but Richard Sackler was an unpredictable presence in board meetings. Often he would ignore whoever was delivering a presentation and become so focused on his laptop that Jonathan would snap. Jonathan is his brother, by the way. Or no, cousin? No, brother. Okay. Richard, get off your computer. Put that away. Whereas the younger Mortimer was most engaged by the financial particulars of any given agenda item, Richard was more interested in the science. He'll ask a question, one executive who sometimes presented to the board recalled, and if you answer it, he'll ask another. And if you answer that one, he'll ask another. And he'll keep going until he gets to a question. And he'll keep going until he gets to a question that you can't answer, and then he's won. Because he's the smartest guy in the room, and he'll ask 100.
Why do you think he did that?
And he'll ask 100 questions if that's what it takes to get to the one you have no answer to. Then the executive continued, if Richard gets his gotcha question, Kathy has to get hers in. Kathy always seemed to want to one-up Richard, according to the executive, but Richard showed her nothing but disdain. It almost felt like the board meetings were mostly about each side of the family trying to prove to the other that they were smarter. So yeah, these are the kind of people we're dealing with here.
Sounds like hell.
Yeah, Richard is such an asshole. Like, I kept thinking a lot, anytime he was brought up, I was just thinking about the footage of him that exists that's in the documentary, Crime of the Century.
Yeah, it's mentioned in the book, too.
Yeah, yeah, they go through, like, the actual transcripts of some of that late as well. But, like, just his...
Because the Sacklers tried real hard to keep that footage buried, and they almost did.
Yeah.
They were real close to keeping it buried.
Well, he doesn't
It's actually shocking to me that it's not buried. What were you going to say?
It's not even so much what he says in the footage. It's how he says it and the look, like, because the author of this book, like, goes, like, will describe it, and he describes it really well. But yeah, like, he just has this air of condescension about him that's, like, kind of amazing. But anyway, we should push on here. I don't know if there's anything else to talk about from that chapter, but the next chapter is Tamper Proof, which essentially, to sum it up, is Purdue decides they're gonna make pills that can be non-abusable, even though they've said this entire time that their regular pills are not abusable. Or, you know what I mean, they're not susceptible to abuse. But anyway, they try, and then they do ultimately develop a crush-proof pill that, like, you cannot crush, I guess, no matter how hard you try. Like, you can take a hammer to it, and it just sort of, like, cracks a little bit, but, like, you can't get it into, like, a fine enough grain to where you could, like, snort it or even especially shoot it. They said it, like, it had, like, the consistency of, like, a gummy bear or something. Like, when you tried to smash it, it would just, like, kind of smush.
I don't know why I would know this, but they did the same thing with Adderall.
Well, we talked about this last time. The Adderall thing was, like, even... The Adderall thing seems almost...
It works the same way. I think it's the same system. I think it's the same tamper-proof system.
Yeah, but I think the thing with the Adderall is that the little tiny balls filled with Adderall inside the pill, those are the crush-proof part. But the whole pill of this Oxycontin is just apparently crush-proof. They said you could maybe break it apart into, like, chunks, but, like, if you tried to snort them, it just gets stuck in your nose. Anyway, it does successfully work to where, like, people can no longer as easily as, like, in the way that they prefer, if no matter, you know, depending on how far along they are in their, like, path of addiction, like, if they need to shoot it or snort it, like, it's no longer possible with this new product. But now
really, they roll this new product out everywhere in the world at the same time.
Everyone what?
They must roll this new version, this new safer version out everywhere in the world at the same time. They wouldn't, like, continue to sell the old pills other places.
You'd be shocked to know that, at least what I remember is, yeah, they continue to sell the regular Oxycontin in Canada for, like, a good year after they...
It causes a big problem in Canada, too. Also, a ton of that gets brought down to America from, like, people going up to Canada to get prescriptions and buy as many as they can and then bringing them back to the States.
Right.
Preferable one.
There's still a lot of the... So basically there's the Oxycontin OC, okay? That's the original one. And then the non-crushable one is Oxycontin or Oxycontin OP. I guess P is for Purdue. I don't know. The funniest part to me about the whole thing is that, I'll just read it here. They pretend like they're doing this out of like concern for public health, but it just so happens that, you know, their patent on the regular Oxycontin is about to come up again. So this is just done out of like fear of the generics, like taking their profit margins down. And, there's a term for this, kind of move called evergreening, where a company just like slightly tweaks their product to get a new patent, which virtually is just extending the old one.
Yep.
But here's a quote from the book. For more than a decade, in the face of an ever-expanding public health crisis, the Sacklers and Purdue had maintained defiantly that the original formulation of Oxycontin was safe and effective. Howard Udell had gone to his grave insisting as much. But after Purdue released the reformulated version of Oxycontin in 2010, as the patent on the original formulation was set to expire, the company made an audacious about-face. Purdue filed papers with the FDA asking the agency to refuse to accept generic versions of the original formulation of Oxycontin, the version the company had been selling all these years. Now here's why? The biggest kicker.
Can't imagine why.
On the grounds that it was unsafe.
No way.
The company said that it was voluntarily withdrawing the original formulation from the market for reasons of safety.
But I thought the time release mechanism made it safe.
Quiet. Shut up, you. On the very day that the patent for the original formulation was set to expire, the FDA, ever obliging, declared that the benefits of the old version of Oxycontin, quote, no longer outweigh the risks. Quote, Purdue is gratified that the FDA has determined that Oxycontin extended-release tablets were withdrawn from sale for reasons of safety, the company said in a press release, noting that the FDA would not accept or approve any application for a generic version of the drug. So, not only do they do this insane thing where they pretend like they've always had a problem with their old product that made them like $30 billion, and that they're doing this out of the kindness of their hearts and concern for the public, but it just so happens that they get to crush all of their competition in one fell swoop along with it. I assume this has continued to today, that Oxycontin time release like is no longer on the market in the United States, right? It must be.
Yeah, it's not. It's not on the market in the
United States. So they just
you can only get the new version,
the smushy one.
Let's call it the gummy version.
Yeah, the gummy bear oxy. Which also the other issue with that the dumb Sacklers don't care about or didn't understand or whatever, was that
some people just get addicted by taking them and swallowing them.
Exactly. Well, you still can get high from swallowing them. Like,
yeah,
it just doesn't hit you like all at once. Also, I imagine you can. One thing I don't think was mentioned in the book. Maybe you remember if I'm wrong, but does the new formulation? So it's not crushable, but is it time release still?
Yeah, it's still time released.
Okay, so then people can still like remove the time release layer, presumably.
I don't know how that works. I think the layer might be like part of the gel, because I think the way they make it uncrushable is they almost make it like in gel form instead of like powder form.
Okay. Anyway, people are still getting like high off of those, but then again, to some degree, yeah, people that are addicted to opioids move away from.
It was too little, too late.
way too little, way too late. And like what happens is like right around the exact same time that this transition happens, there's an explosion in heroin use in the US.
And it's almost like the market opened up.
And the thing is the Sacklers look at that and go, see, this proves our point. These people were just junkies who were going to get their fix wherever they could.
Yeah.
While it's the exact opposite case where, I mean, then like actual studies were done years later showing that the removal of the original Oxycontin like directly led to like heroin uptick. Heroin and fentanyl, but I think in the beginning heroin.
I don't remember the four states, but there were four states where Oxycontin wasn't like sold or advertised the same way it was in the other 46 states. And all those states had like way less addiction rates, yada, yada, yada. Even after like, cause I think they started selling Oxycontin like everyone else in like 2013 instead of like, I'm so bad with dates, 2007. Was that when nationwide? And their addiction rates were so much lower. They didn't have the heroin problem, which all made it kind of connected. It's like, okay, the Sacklers really did start this. I know that's later, but.
No, I mean, we can jump around. I mean, I'm just using the chapters as like a way to try not to forget anything big. But yeah, for sure. I mean, there's like, even without the studies, like it just makes like, it's like common sense connection that like, if this company has already gotten so many people hooked on opioids, like, and this is like a common story amongst people who like started with Oxycontin, even people that started with it like not thinking that they weren't setting out to get high originally, but then they find themselves like shooting heroin. Like, you know, there's a description in the book of like just talking about how much your, I don't know, just like the power of addiction, basically. Like, oh, you think you're squeamish about needles? Well, like, wait till you feel like you're about to die from withdrawals. Like, you're going to do, like, basically anything to get rid of that feeling, which is, you know, I mean, most people know how withdrawals work, but it's especially bad with drugs like this.
I mean, I can't even handle nicotine withdrawals, so.
Then there's some other, like, kind of just, like, little details, like, like Richard just being really like meddling in the company still, like, but that we kind of talked about that before. At one point he wants to like actually go on like sales calls with the salesman, and people are trying so hard to get him not to come along because they're afraid he's just going to like throw handfuls of pills at doctors, like literally
like reach into his pocket and start pelting them.
But then like, yeah, it shows that like no one can like dare cross him, even though he's not, you know, he's a board member, but like he's not like the CEO, like, but yeah, like he's got basically, he can do whatever he wants in that company. The next chapter kind of, it takes us further into this like third generation of Sacklers. Madeline Sackler.
The director?
Yeah. This is Jonathan Sackler's daughter.
I feel like I saw that movie. I didn't realize at the time that it was by her.
Which one? She has like three movies, I think.
The one, God, I forgot his name. The one about the inmates.
I do it with Jeffrey Wright.
Yeah.
Yeah. I never saw any of them, but so yeah, she, you know, same story, like best schools, blah, blah, blah. World is her oyster. She was going to go into like medical school and she decides she likes photography and she ends up making her first like feature length documentary when she's like 28. It was called The Lottery. It was about charter schools, which charter schools were like a passion of her father's, I guess, as well.
They're a passion of rich people.
Yeah. Like, apparently her... So there's like kind of like multiple wings of the Sackler family, and the sort of like intergenerational hatred continues. Like, there's a lot... I don't know. There's just splits amongst them, but the Jonathan Sackler is a little bit more of a, at least on the surface, he wants to be seen as like a liberal, I guess. That was kind of the sense I got.
Like, I get the sense that all of them want to be somewhat seen as neo-libs.
Well, there's liberal and then there's like, I mean, I think Richard is very much like a libertarian, like apolitical, maybe if anything type, but because there's some quote from Richard talking about like how the liberals are trying to destroy him and stuff.
That's true. I think Richard wants to be king of the world.
Yeah.
And probably considered himself as much.
But even the more sort of touchy-feely, like feel-good Sacklers are still like just as
monstrous
and like complicit in all of this stuff. They're all board members. They're all approving all this shit. They're all making huge amounts of money from it. And so yeah, when like they had a passion for like charter schools, which you know are like kind of famously like a disastrous idea. So anyway, she made this documentary, but then she made another documentary just film, like a fictional film with Jeffrey Wright and real prisoners. They went into a prison, and the film was called OG. It was about...
Didn't she make this while she was in film school?
I don't remember that part, but...
I think she was
older because her first documentary came out when she was 28. The book kind of like rapidly goes through her youth, like just quickly describing like... Oh.
See, the reason I was thinking that, I remember, and this was probably something else that I'm just like connecting the two, but it was talking about how one of her films, like, and I think this was like a film school film, she used like locations and actors in it that would just been impossible for a normal film school student. But because she's a Sackler and, you know, has unlimited money.
Yeah. I mean, I'm sure that's true. I'm sure her family connections and money have helped in some way. I don't know if the book gets into that too specifically, but
yeah, I don't think it does. I just remember it like sticking out to me.
But the first sentence of this chapter is the only Sackler to ever go to jail was Madeline Sackler. And that's like, ooh, what? What's this about? And then you realize he's just kind of, he's being coy.
Tongue in cheek.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's being tongue in cheek.
And yeah, so she does make this film in jail, and it's like critically lauded by like, I don't know, like George Clooney and like just fill in the blank, like Hollywood liberal type. People like her movies. But the main point about bringing her up, I think, in the book and I mean in the podcast as well, is that she like refuses to see any connection, any weird connection between her family's immense wealth, which she like lives off of essentially. And then she makes this film about like the mass incarceration. And well, I think the actor Jeffrey Wright, he kind of described it pretty well himself, because he didn't know all of this stuff going into the movie, and he found out about it later. And he basically said the film was ultimately fraudulent and deceptive because of her like refusal to take any sort of responsibility, or not even responsibility, but even disclose her family background and history, considering that like some of the people in the film are like, you know, the dialogue that she wrote is like, yeah, my mom was like, it was like my family was on pills and like blah blah blah, and like that's how I basically grew up to become who I am. And she doesn't see any weird like connection there. But I think this is just further illustrating like this kind of insulated world that these people live in. And I feel like it almost like maybe like each subsequent generation is like more insulated than the last.
Yeah,
it feels like it'd be especially,
well, they're becoming more and more rich, so like they don't live in the normal world.
But then they also can like look back on their like previous generations of their family and be like, oh, well, they all lived this way. So it's like even more normalized, you know, like when those first three brothers got rich, like that was like there was no precedent for that. Not that they were good people either, but I don't know. It's kind of weird how the whole thing works, this generational wealth. But yeah, so I don't know. She's when she was kind of confronted about it, like in an interview, she would just like deflect or get like outraged, you know. My family's business has nothing to do with me. Like I've never worked for that company. You know, she just doesn't want to see that there's any connection there. And I remember one part of the book, he describes she is living like relatively modestly. Like her apartment was only like a $4 million apartment in Los Angeles or something.
Jesus, only.
Which, only. Yeah, on a relative scale, I guess she was basically a bohemian type. But
I mean, at least she came out front and was honest about all her connections to the family the whole time, and really discussed like her involvement with OxyContin and when she like was talking to these inmates. When she was filming the Wright movie, which I can't fucking keep the name in my head.
Jeffrey Wright?
And she was filming that and like she was talking to people where opioids really had like ruined their lives and like the drug of war, the drug on wars. Yeah, the drug on wars had ruined their life. She would talk about her connection to it. She would admit guilt to it, really wanted to help and be different from her family, right? All that happened.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, of course not. None of that happened, right? I mean, she kept it as secret as possible, like the rest of the family.
Yeah, nobody wants to talk about it. The whole goes to the bigger point in the book of how the family members try to keep this delusional belief intact that they are separate from Purdue. Even though it's couldn't be, I mean, they are like one and the same. There's a part that talks about how the way that Richard and Kathy would treat people in the office, even though, again, they were just board members. But, you know, they just come in when they feel like it and yell at people, basically. I like this description of it from, I think, an ex-employee. It said, "They would just inflict themselves on us," a former Purdue executive who dealt with the family recalled. "What Kathy liked to do was call you into her office late in the day and just lecture you for hours," he said. "Nobody on the business side would ever pull her into any kind of business discussion because she wasn't helpful in any sense of the word. Everybody called her Dr. Kathy, but I don't know that anyone was really impressed with her doctoring credentials. To some employees, this air of self-importance could seem comical. They liked that sense that they were serious business people," one former staffer who dealt with the family pointed out. "They confused being good at something with stepping in shit and getting lucky. The thing I found specifically with the family was that the next generation, they struck gold in the backyard, basically. It's like you moved to Odessa, Texas, and said, 'What is this black stuff coming out of the ground?' Outside of OxyContin, the company had never been that successful. Without OxyContin, it would be this sleepy $50 million pharma company you'd never heard of. But the success of one drug had given rise to a self-regarding aura of superhuman business prowess," the staff continued. "The Sacklers had come to think of themselves as the smart billionaires who knew better. More than one person who worked at Purdue during this era likened the experience to the acidly humorous HBO show Succession, in which a trio of overindulged adult children vie, haplessly, to seize control of a conglomerate built by their hard-driving father." Yeah, that was the Succession reference there.
Sounds like Arrested Development to me.
The lighter version of Succession, yeah. Yeah. Even Succession, though, like, I thought about it, and I was like, they're an evil company as well, but, like, they're nothing close to the Sacklers.
Oh no, all the Sacklers. Like I don't even want people in jail. Like I usually think it's bad for people to be in jail, but they deserve it. Actually, what I think they deserve is to have all of their wealth stripped away from them and to be like forced out onto the streets.
Yeah, start from the
bottom. Exiled, charge treason. I don't know. Can we like expel them to the moon?
Get Bezos on that.
Oh God, he didn't make enough money this year, so he got some child tax credits.
You know, we haven't talked about this in the podcast yet. The last thing we mentioned about Bezos was him getting the contract for the fucking moon landing shit.
He's planning on going to the moon.
But, him and his brother are going to just take one of the rockets up for fun into space and then come back. Did you hear that?
Yeah, I hope it explodes.
Everyone's been saying that. No, I just feel like people are Twitter are like, it'd be a shame if I think Will on Tropos said it really funny. He's like, I hope there are no big challenges for them. Then there's like, enter Michael Bloomberg, like just a brief, you know, like unsurprisingly, it mentioned that they're friends with Michael Bloomberg. Also, there's one funny little detail of like how the Sacklers love to just slap their name onto like any kind of like museum or whatever, or university. To them, then the most absurd example was they have their name on a single elevator in the Tate Modern in London. It just says like, this elevator was gifted to us by the Sackler family. It's like an elevator that you're taking to get from like one exhibit to the next. Like, it's not like a gallery, the Sackler gallery. It's the Sackler elevator. Or sorry, escalator? No, it was elevator. Anyway, and then of course, there's tax evasion. They evaded hundreds of millions of dollars in taxes by like routing money through Bermuda, which brings us to their international network of companies. That's all falls under the name Mundi Pharma or Mundi. I said Mundi in my head, but and yeah, so they, you know, they realize they can't. So after all of that shit about like OxyContin time release is dangerous, we're so glad that the FDA is taking it off the market now. They're just pushing it all over the world, like all over the world. And the biggest place they focus on is China. And apparently it works out pretty well in their favor.
But yeah, this is like normal because like what they're going to do, they're losing the patent in America. So the next thing to do is just start selling their drugs in other countries.
But like I said, it's even funnier because they're not just losing their patent. They like intentionally threw their old patent under the bus so that no one else could use it. They said it's too dangerous.
Yeah.
We can only use this new version of OxyContin that can't be crushed. But I'm pretty sure, maybe I missed something, but I'm pretty sure they were going to continue selling the regular OxyContin that got them their original billions in other countries. They weren't going to sell like the reformulated one. But in any case, they take the same exact game plan that they used in the United States, and they start bringing it around the world. And there was a thing where they continued to sell the regular OxyContin in Canada for, yeah, like a year after they phased it out in America. So much for it being too dangerous. But then they go on trial in Kentucky again. I saw the number somewhere, and now I can't remember where, but like there have been like, I want to say it was like well over 2,000 individual lawsuits brought against Purdue over the years. And this was a bigger one. You know, this wasn't like this wasn't like a single family suing them or something. This was a, you know, the as state of Kentucky.
19, 36 states were suing Purdue. And it was thousands of lawsuits.
Yeah.
As of 2020, 49 states have filed suits. But Purdue's lucky because something happens to kind of like negate a lot of this because they bundle everything together, right?
That's after this Kentucky thing. So like just quickly, what happens in Kentucky is it's kind of a repeat of Virginia, but worse for the state. Like the state has plenty of evidence, you know, and the Sacklers just
they had enough to take down the Sacklers, like literally.
Yeah, they actually, that was the big difference, is they finally got the actual Sacklers, including Richard, like on the
stand. And this is where the dispositions, like the video footage from the documentary come from.
Right, where he's being like just remarkably condescending and like literally keeps saying like, I can't recall, like about like, how much money does your family have? I couldn't be sure.
This has the lawyer, the lawyer who made the comment is like, would you say death is a great way to treat pain or whatever?
Yeah. And he, and Richard Sackler just like chuckles like, I wouldn't say death has a lot of efficacy in pain management. Yeah, this guy is just a fucking nightmare. But basically like the result of the trial in Kentucky. I mean, we got to kind of gloss over it here. But like I said, similar to the one in Virginia, sort of. But it shows us this other motivation too, though. So it was settled. Like they just, you know, the Sacklers paid, you know, a pocket lint, you know, speeding ticket amount of money. And part of the settlement, though, every time they've done this, is to have the records sealed. And yep. Which they do successfully. I guess they were reopened or something because, you know, we've seen that.
Yeah, video it talks footage. About how they were reopened later. It was the lawyer, Haley, who ends up suing them later. She gets them reopened.
Right, okay. And then there's this kind of big thing, the Region Zero list. So it's shown, this also, like, let's say in steps the LA Times. So the LA Times has like three pretty like,
these are some of my favorite articles ever written about OxyContin. I know I've brought them up to you. I don't know if I've brought them up on the podcast, but you, like even before we were reading the book,
you
like,
brought,
I know the one I told you to read was the 12 hours in hell, which is maybe my favorite article that I've read about OxyContin back when it was written,
which is mentioned in the book as well. Yeah. We talked about it last week, I think, or sometime. But yeah, they have three kind of landmark articles. The first one is in 2013, and it's about this Region Zero list specifically, which the Region Zero list is a list of basically, you could call them problematic or suspicious doctors and clinics that Purdue itself kept on file. Like this was not something like generated by a law enforcement agency. This was their own files. And yeah, it was like we talked about, like places where unusual, like extremely unusual high numbers of these products are being prescribed, like that, you know, that should be considered suspicious. And Purdue knew of this the whole time, and it's obvious, and they never alerted anyone. And they just kept pushing salespeople to keep selling there, and they kept supplying. And it wasn't just clinics, it was the pharmacies as well that are complicit too. So anyway, it was just another just like blatant, like, you know, violation, I guess, of yeah. their we're going to be good from now on bullshit from the last lawsuit. And there's a sort of like split in the company. They've gone through like numerous CEOs, or they will like throughout this, like, I don't know, last 10 years of the story, I guess. And one of them, though, they brought in like his whole thing,
guy who wanted to like shake up the company.
Yeah, well, he wanted to move away from opioids. He was like,
yeah, well, he thought the only way to save the company, like if they really wanted to, I think the Sacklers, even though it's kind of said in the book, but not said, I think a big part of the family knew the company was going to just like get sued out of existence. So that's why they start moving all the money out. And they did bring in a new CEO. And I think he was under the opinion of like, the CEO's job is to make sure a company is running and profitable, right? And he realized that the market for opioids had become toxic. So he's like, well, we got to move away from this. But I think the family, they just wanted to get as much profit as possible because they knew the company's going away or the form they have it in. So get as much profit now, take it out and run.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. Yeah, maybe they saw the writing on the wall. I think that's very likely. I also think, like, as we've kind of established the psychology of someone like Richard Sackler.
Well, like, Richard, I don't think saw the writing on the wall.
I think he's just obsessively wanting to maximize. Like,
and I think some of his legacy, too. He refuses to let go because it's his baby. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah. And all, but also his, if you like combine like arrogant, like I'm the smartest guy in the room type personality with fucking unbelievable amounts of money and privilege that insulate you from every real world, like, consequence, you're going to be like, we'll call it a special brand of human being that like doesn't really, I think the book kind of goes into that a little bit too, where when you cultivate a cult, like have a culture of like just people who say yes to everything, like it's both like a, you know, it's a blessing and a curse to that person because, yeah, I mean, like, I guess I'm just saying, Richard Sackler, he never had to hear anyone say no, basically. And when he did, when it was in the form of like lawyers or newspaper columnists criticizing his company, aka him, he would like throw a little baby fit about it, you know.
Yeah, he would pay to make it go away.
Right. So they also, yeah, they actually tried to do that to some degree with these Los Angeles Times stories. So then there was a second story in 2016. That's the one you've talked about where they go into the 12-hour effectiveness lie about OxyContin and how that basically perpetuated addiction even more than it would have normally been, right?
Yeah, it would wear off after about 8 hours, 8 to 9 hours. And then that gives you enough time to feel the withdrawal syndrome. So you're more likely to go and take an extra pill or you feel like you need a higher dose. But your doctor's telling you to only take it every 12 hours. And if you're doing that and you start upping your dose, or even if you're just on a regular dose, you do feel those withdrawal syndromes. So your body and mind start telling you, hey, you got to take more. Right. It's almost like manufactured withdrawal syndromes. It's going to make you want to take the medicine more and more. It gets you addicted. There's even some studies that I think that was brought up in the LA Times article that had they been subscribing it 3 times a day, which would be against the advertising, that maybe less people would have got addicted to it because it would have been easier to follow doctor's orders. But upping the dosage but still keeping it 2 times a day actually was making it more addictive because it gives you enough time to hit the peak and valley.
Right.
And the Sacklers wanted it that way. I wonder why.
Yeah, I mean, at this point, I have to assume that was all purposeful. And even if it wasn't, when they found out what was happening, they were just like, oh, what a wonderful side effect for us. Then the next chapter is Temple of Greed, which introduces us to Nan Golden.
Yeah, she's awesome.
Tell us about Nan Golden.
Nan Golden is a photographer, pretty famous photographer. I think she operated outside of the Bay Area, but she was heavily involved, like with AIDS rights, HIV rights activists in the 80s, and also in the artist community, she experimented with a lot of drugs over her lifetime and eventually got clean from heroin. But later in life, she got prescribed Oxycontin and got terribly addicted to Oxycontin and then got off Oxycontin and then decided to wage war with the Sacklers. That's sort of like the footnotes.
Yeah, she becomes one of the top like public.
Well, she starts
public.
She
voices.
Starts Pain, which Pain is like this protest group against the Sacklers, and they do some really cool stuff. I actually remember seeing in the news when this stuff was happening, like throwing the prescription sheets down in the Met, or basically protesting right outside of Purdue building, ambushing the Sacklers when they're at public events, etc.
Yeah, she...
Which was, like, mirroring some of the stuff they did during, like, the AIDS crisis in the 80s.
Right.
Which is where she figured out a lot of her activist tactics from.
Yeah, I'm trying to remember all the... some of the things they did at these, like, demonstrations were... one of them just sounded pretty cool, where... Oh, what was it? At the Met, where the... That... Fuck that piece of the what is it? Dendur?
Yeah, Dendur, the temple from Egypt.
Yeah, that Arthur Sackler had put there in the museum. They posted up like right by that, and I think in more than one occasion it describes Nan Golden as stepping into a water fountain before starting to scream at everyone, but. I just noticed that as like, I don't know, a detail, but they would like, they just started like throwing like hundreds and hundreds of, like the, you know, orange pill bottles.
They did orange pill bottles. One of the things they did was they had these, banners unfurled that said like, Sacklers are murderers. And when the banners unfurled at the, when they unfurled the banners, they also had like hundreds, maybe thousands of like prescription slips fall down from the sky and shower people with Oxycontin prescription slips. They threw pill bottles of like previous people's Oxycontin prescriptions.
I think they actually, I mean, this is a small detail, but I think at least in one of them, they actually, they carefully put like their own printed words onto these pill bottles, and then yeah, anyway, they did like some, they did some cool like it sort of reminded me of like Operation Mayhem, like Fight Club stuff, but for an actual good cause.
Yeah, well, I mean, she was also heavily connected to the art world. Like, she had art displayed in the Met, she had art displayed in the Louvre, other places, and she was like instrumental of getting the Sackler's name out of some of these museums,
yeah,
being like connected to that world.
Yeah, that's true.
Which, I mean, one of the only things that stopped some of the protesting was COVID-19, but like, she advocated hard to get the Sacklers in trouble. She wanted to watch the family burn, which I understand. And if nothing else, she did, she was a big, like a crucial component to getting their names taken off of some of these places.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, I like that chapter. I don't know how much there more there's to really say about it, but I mean, you covered it pretty well.
She does come up a bit later again, but I mean, just more about her protesting.
Yeah.
Which I think she's still doing.
Probably, because I mean, spoiler alert, Purdue is still making Oxycontin. So the next chapter, I think, goes into where the like
so pain stands for prescription addiction intervention. Now I just needed to tell what it stood for, but I couldn't remember exactly.
Yeah,
it was prescription addiction intervention. Now
that is the group
started
name.
In 2017. I guess they're big, like project, we'll call them Project Mayhem things they did was they did something at the Arthur M. Sackler Museum, the Guggenheim, the Met, The National Portrait Gallery, the Freer Sackler Gallery, and the Louvre. And the Louvre, I think, was one of the biggest ones.
Yeah. Oh, also, she seemed to think that she was being like intimidated by people that were
investigator.
Almost yeah, certainly had, like, hired by Purdue.
But people following her and her friends, like cars and.
The author describes why it's hard to prove that type of stuff because it goes through like so many different like layers and channels of different people, and that oftentimes the intimidator, the private eye, whatever,
they don't even know who they're hired by.
Yeah, they don't know who's hired them ultimately. They just know they have to follow a certain person and take pictures or whatever. But yeah. That was happening to Nan and her group. And the next chapter talks about Tasmania, which is where, like, I think the bulk of the raw opium comes from for, like,
this all is where, like, Johnson & Johnson had all their farms, their opiate farms.
Yeah.
Another player enters.
Huh?
I said another player enters because I didn't say Purdue. I said Johnson & Johnson.
Yeah. I mean, I think part of this is about how, like, so the author makes it clear that, like, you know, Purdue is not the only company selling these kind of opioids by any stretch.
They're the company that made the playbook. They're like the team captain. They're the quarterback.
Yeah, they
quarterbacks are team captains, right?
Sure.
Cool. Here on the sports podcast where we make sports allusions to sports constantly to describe leftist sorry.
Slam dunk. That's right. So in Tasmania, yeah, Johnson & Johnson, they own like just a ton of poppy fields in Tasmania, and they're like super genetically engineered poppies that have just like a much higher yield of...
Well, they figured out a better way to process the poppies too, because like it's actually pretty hard to like, if you say you have just like farmers out there like picking them individually, but they made like giant machines that would like basically pick the plant from the root and then grind them down like in this like gigantic coffee grinder, so they could use it to make their poppy opioid pills.
Right.
The book talks about that, right? Or have I just read that somewhere else?
It's also in the documentary. They show I don't know what you call that, a thresher. Like anyway, yeah.
Look at you with your words and stuff.
Well, I don't know.
Not
I don't know.
Giant coffee grinder.
Well, that's a different part of it. I'm talking about the thing that rides through the fields and pulls out the plants.
Oh, cropper.
Sure. backhoe. Anyway, the point is that Tasmania, as the book here says, grows 85% of all of the thebaine. That's the name of this alkaloid. It's like the active ingredient that is needed to make opioids. They grow 85% of that in the world. And so, yeah, the point is that, you know, Johnson & Johnson is also very much so in this business. The way that they would like, entice the farmers to give up growing their like normal crops of like food and switch to poppies was by bribing them, like the same way that, like, you know, Purdue would bribe doctors with, or bribe their sales team, incentivize their sales team. They would say, here's like a all expenses paid vacation, have a luxury car. And, you know, it worked because money talks and bullshit walks. So the idea that Purdue wasn't alone in this, but that Purdue tries to use this as a justification, and how that's bullshit. So The author writes, of course, it wasn't just Purdue applying pressure, talking about applying pressure to the DEA and so on. This would become a central plank in the Sackler family's defense. In 2016, Johnson & Johnson sold the Tasmanian Alkaloids facility. Physicians were becoming more cautious about prescribing opioids, and by that point, many Americans were surveying the carnage that two decades of widespread opioid prescribing had created, and looking around for someone to blame. Sounding very much like Arthur Sackler in 1961 when he insisted to the panel of U.S. senators that the McAdams agency was really just a minor concern, the Sacklers protested that OxyContin's market share was never more than 4%. And there is some truth to that being their market share, but then there's also some untruth to it. But the reason that the Sacklers are enemy number one...
Untruth to it. It's later revealed, but
well, what's that? Just say
the fact that they owned one of the companies making generics.
Right. Yeah. So they're like,
the biggest company making generics was actually just one of their shell companies.
Right. Yeah. Which is a classic Sackler family move. In the early first part of the book, I think we might have missed this part too when we were talking about it. But yeah, Arthur Sackler owned like two competing like marketing firms.
Yeah.
And
I don't think we talked about it on the podcast, but I remember it from the book.
Yeah. So yeah, they did the same kind of underhanded shit here, of course. There's like tons of shell companies involved, which comes up later as well, but so even McKinsey said that OxyContin, the Purdue drug, created the opioid market in America. And they're being paid to make them look good. So if even they're saying that, it says a lot. So I think this is where like this gigantic case gets sort of pieced together.
Sort of like brought up. And this is the case from the New York attorney. She was New York, right?
Yeah, well, there's many attorneys involved in this, though, right? Okay, so let's just skip ahead to chapter 27, named defendants. Richard Sackler's daughter-in-law, Joss Sackler, was married to his son, David. I'm only bringing her up because she's hilariously stupid and out of touch.
Mary Antoinette of the Sackler family. She's a fashion designer.
Yeah, she's a fashion designer who made like really
among many other things.
Really ugly like hoodies or something. And
I said, take our pills.
Yeah. But she is just another example of someone totally connected to the family that only wants to be connected to the family when it's convenient for her, but not when it's inconvenient. And so she marries David, and she had lived like a very privileged life as well. I think she's also just like born into wealth. Yeah, daughter of a Canadian diplomat. She'd gone to high school in Japan, nurtured a youthful ambition to become a spy. Instead, studied linguistics in grad school in New York. And then used all of that experience to make like handbags or whatever. But,
of course.
Oh, her dissertation in grad school was about the narco propaganda of drug cartels in Mexico and how these criminal drug rings endeavor, as she put it, to garner public support from local communities. Which is kind of funny, considering what family she's about to marry into.
Yep.
I mean, okay, here's a further description directly from the book. She might have looked the part of a billionaire's wife, slim and blonde and very fit, with lips that puffed and puckered. But she was no mere trophy, she insisted. She started a club for young rich women who drink wine. Or, as she referred to it, a members-only, female-led collective celebrating the intersection of art, wine, fashion, and culture. I just like how the author reduces that to women who like to drink wine. Sorry. It just reeks of, like, you know, reality TV, how fucking whatever, wives of whatever.
Yeah.
The wives of Purdue, the wives of opioids. And she also apparently was a mountaineer. She could speak three other languages, whatever. Yeah, she made these hideous clothes, but because she's connected, because she already has money, she got fashion shows and stuff. But one of the moments that I thought was funny was that she invited Courtney Love to her fashion unveiling.
Yeah, I thought you were going to enjoy this part when I was reading it. I was like, oh yeah, Josh loves Nirvana.
Well, that's not even why. It's just because she was she's one of the most famously addicted people in American popular culture in the last, I don't know, 20 years. But yeah, Courtney Love didn't like that at all when she found out who their family was, and she was, I think, I'm having trouble finding it right now, but I remember basically what it said. She
this is fucking
she
bullshit.
Had just kicked opioids for the 800th time, like a year before this, and specifically OxyContin was one of the main
one
things.
One of the ones listed, right?
Yeah. I mean, it's stronger than heroin, as we've mentioned a few times, but I don't know. Maybe there's not much else to really say about that, but I think we might have to really kind of breeze past some of the details now if we want to get to the end of the book, right? Basically, there's just one more big event, which is the huge lawsuit, right?
Huge lawsuit. And it actually looks like the Sacklers are going to go down. They could definitely go down, except things happen.
Except they don't.
They don't.
Yeah.
Spoilers. Because of legal minutiae and bankruptcy laws in America.
Yeah.
So all these court cases start to gather around, and they gather all this evidence. They get the evidence unsealed from the Kentucky case. The depositions from Richard, et cetera, get unsealed. I think that they're actually unsealed in 2014, if I remember right. So a bit before the case, and they're unsealed by a different court. But Healy puts together this awesome court case, and other states are also following suits, and other small local communities are following suits, counties and towns and cities are following suits. And it ends up being 3,000 cases, like you say. And I don't remember what the legal thing's called, but they all end up getting bundled into one giant case, which actually is a good thing for the Sacklers, because that means they don't have to go through 1,000 court cases. I think they should have had to go through 1,000 court cases, but they all gets bundled into a massive mega court case. And we win the case.
Is that how it ended?
Well, kind of. So skipping around some, what happens, that case is...
I think we should start this. I think one thing important to start with the whole case with is that the Sacklers, in a sort of roundabout way, handpick the judge that's going to oversee their case.
Yeah.
Or is that later? Or
it's kind of later. This is so.
This is before it goes. This is before it goes to bankruptcy court, right?
They handpick their bankruptcy judge.
That's what I was talking about. Yeah.
See, what I'm saying is, we win the criminal case. But during all this time, the Sacklers have been pulling money out of Purdue and moving it to offshore accounts, moving it to personal accounts, to where Purdue's basically just a shell of a company at this point. They have
they said they had $1 billion, even less than a billion. Yeah, it was $100 something.
I thought it was $500 million.
It's something like that. Yeah, yeah.
the company doesn't have enough money at this point to even pay its employees. So they're going to have to start doing massive layoffs. They're not going to pay their pensions. They get it to the point to where they can fall bankruptcy for the company because they can't afford their pensions. They can't afford to pay employees, et cetera, which means that they can fall bankruptcy. The company can fall bankruptcy. And this is where they handpick the bankruptcy judge who is once in the past helped another pharmaceutical company out. Yeah, I'm just going to say the judge helped another pharmaceutical company out. They're the ones who had made the contraceptive that was killing young girls who were using it. What was the name of that contraceptive? They made a contraceptive that was killing young girls, and they did the same thing, got the same judge to be like, okay, well, we can't charge the family. It's not their fault. They're not the company. But this is great because all these, if they don't settle with the company in bankruptcy, the company's just never going to be able to pay whatever fines are actually charged against it. So they get in this like catch-22 to where like if the lawyers want people to get anything, they have to settle. Otherwise, they win the case, but the company's in bankruptcy and there's no money for the company to pay the fines. So the fines kind of just get waived, unlike my student loans, which will never be waived.
Yeah.
So what does happen with the bankruptcy judge?
I mean, one of the things they do to get the bankruptcy judge of their choice is they just, for $30, they just change the address of their corporate headquarters to being somewhere else.
Texas.
Was it Texas? Okay.
I think it's Texas. Because it was New York. They wanted to change to Texas.
And it's this guy. I remember his last name is Drain. And he's just like a real... I don't even think he's necessarily corrupt.
He's a technocrat.
And he's also just... Yeah, he's very focused on... In the narrowest sense, he's like bankruptcy
very
law.
Very focused on like legal minutiae.
Yeah.
And from what the book says, it apparently bankruptcy law is about the most minutiae of law. Like it's all just like finance guys and technical and just very numbers oriented.
Right.
See, they get the case with Drain and, Drain only wants to hear about the finance side. He refuses to hear anything about people that have been hurt.
Yeah, it's considered immaterial or whatever.
Yeah. And the thing that...
But they all... Like the family ends up paying, like, nothing. Am I right?
Yeah, the family ends up paying nothing. The thing with the bankruptcy cases is the company can file bankruptcy... And the judge can make the call that, okay, since the family has lost their company, they can't be charged with any felony charges, which is basically where it's going, which that hasn't happened yet. The Sacklers can still be charged felony charges from what I understand. Like they have not made any final decisions in like current day, but they chose this judge because what they're hoping for is that he'll make the call that they cannot be charged anymore. Felony charges for what they've done at Purdue because the company's already been charged the charges.
Yeah, they can't be tried for what the company has been tried for. They basically we can't go after their personal funds. They can only go after the company's funds, which have been purposely drained. Hey, Drain, Judge Drain. Purposely drained by the family for like the years leading up to this, like because they were anticipating something like this to happen. And they've got like just shell companies within shell companies within shell companies all over the world, all sorts of different banks. So at one point, like one of the big decisions was like, will the prosecution be able to go after like the family's personal assets? And what I don't even remember how that ended up though now. Anyway, the final go ahead.
Sorry, the way it ends up, they're in these cases and Drain the judge, he really wants the prosecution to settle. Like he wants them to settle and take the Sackler's settlement. And the Sackler's, their settlement offer is basically, hey, we will turn Purdue into a public trust company.
Right.
We ran by the public. we will give you so many billion dollars. I don't remember how much. Not much, though. $3 billion is what I want to say, which is way less than the $12 billion the Sacklers will probably take it out of the company. And we will not admit any guilt. We will not apologize. That's the big thing. They refuse to add any type of apology in, and they just want to make that clear because the Sacklers do not think they've done anything wrong and refuse to say that they've done anything wrong. And the lawyers like Healy, et cetera, and even like the people, like the victims, most of them would prefer that the Sacklers admit to wrongdoing, that even like just settlements. But they get it to a point to where it's like, look, even if you win this case, the company's in bankruptcy. They don't have enough money to pay out. You'll get nothing if you win the case. If you take our settlement, at least you get something. But we're not going to, like, you know, admit to wrongdoing. No way, Jose.
Mm-hmm.
That's basically how it turns out. It comes into this, like, catch-22 situation to where, like, the victims can choose to get something or the lawyers can choose to get something. And even Drain's kind of pushed on this. Like, look, you're getting nothing the other way if you just keep pursuing the case.
Yeah.
And it's shitty.
It was interesting. There was a part described where, because this is during COVID. I mean, this is all happening like not that long ago. Part we're talking about. It's still happening. Now.
Like, you still see headlines about it happening at the moment.
They're like family members of people who had, you know, died, like were trying to like make a statement during these proceedings, these like Zoom proceedings. And the judge just like didn't seem to know what to do except to be like, well, that's not it's really what sad. This, that's not what this part is for.
And see how you're confused here, but that's not what we're at trial for. We're
right.
Just talk about the particulars of money. We're not talking about death or crime. We're talking about money. So yeah, it basically just ends to where they're forced to take the settlement and the Sacklers do not have to admit guilt. And
but surely they must not be able to sell opioids anymore.
Well, you would think that.
No. Oh, okay. That's one of the most fucked up parts about all of this, right? Is so they said that they would turn Purdue into a, what was it, like a public trust. But how are they gonna fund the public trust?
By selling opioids.
Yeah. And their whole thing was the public trust, like, mission statement was to, like...
And the way the company was to, like, pay the fines, or the settlement, the way the settlement's going to pay fines is not from the Sackler's pockets, but through the sales.
Right.
That the public trust makes.
So they're just going to keep selling opioids the same way they always have been, essentially.
Yeah.
But
finally, their company won't be a black box.
But the public trust was supposed to be, didn't they say it was like specifically gonna like target like recovery and rehab and like addiction treatment stuff?
Yeah,
with money made by selling OxyContin.
Yes,
it's pretty wild. It's wild shit.
That's what I said.
So there are a lot of. I was just going to say there are a lot of really interesting details in here, but like as a audience, you might be able to hear in our voices. It's hard to keep it all together in our heads. Like, I mean, and we broke this book up into three parts. It's a long book. It's like 600 pages, but
basically it ends with the Sacklers getting away with it.
It ends with the Sacklers getting away with it. The only small justice is in the final chapter
Which is called the unnaming.
Their good name is kind of taken away from them.
Which is maybe the ultimate insight insult to them. Just going back three generations to Isaac Sackler, the father of the brothers, who said a fortune can always be rebuilt, but a good name can never be rebuilt.
Right. Except, you know what's, I mean... That sounds nice, like some nice folk wisdom, but It kind of can be. They can just. Yeah. They can
look
just.
At Bill Gates.
They can
look
just at, become. Well, no, they can at, just. They can just become silent partners in another giant like corporation again.
No, I mean that's rebuilding your fortune.
Okay. Right, yeah. Like, I, you're right. Yeah. So the name is tarnished basically forever. Yeah. And like it took so many universities and museums so long to finally, they were kind of kicking and screaming not to do
yeah,
it.
Yeah, with the unnaming, I think it really starts at Tufts University, where
but they were they were one of the more difficult ones. They were like refusing to do it for a while.
Yeah, but I mean it starts at Tufts. So it might start at the Louvre, but in the university sphere, the reason I say it starts at Tufts is because they're mainly funded by the Sacklers. Like their biomedical lab is like funded directly by the Sacklers. They're like the university that refuses to teach Dreamland, the novel that came out earlier about all this stuff, to their incoming med students.
Yeah, but that's the right.
The med students there, the actual students protest that they don't want to learn in a Sackler building. They don't want to be funded by the Sacklers. Like the students basically protest it. And yeah. The students do such a good job of protesting it that the university concedes and decides to take the name down. And when Tufts does it, that's when places like Harvard and Yale and some of the bigger schools also start to refuse the money from the Sacklers. So that's what's happening in the university world. In the art world, Godin has gotten the Louvre to take down their name, and then the other museums, the ones who aren't contractually obliged to keep the name, take it down. The ones who are contractually obliged, they start to like redo the signs to where the Sackler names in like super tiny print and right. Like give like clever names to exhibits, and people stop to the Sacklers dismay. All these places stop taking their philanthropic money.
Right. And they lose standing like amongst their rich peers in some ways as well.
Yeah.
I think the author even talks about how in like pop culture, like their name starts to break through. Like I think he describes like celebrities making fun of the Sacklers on like the Stephen Colbert like show or something.
Late Night Tonight. Because like it mentions that, maybe Jonathan's son's favorite show or Mortimer's son's favorite show is Late Night Tonight. And he's like in middle school at the time. And the mom finds out that, that they're going to do a segment on the Sackler family. And she tries to like talk to John Oliver personally to be like, don't do this segment. It's our son's favorite show. He watches it with all of his friends. And well, John Oliver, much like many celebrities, doesn't really talk to, I mean, it's a show.
So there's at least some sort of turning of the tide, as much as like, you know, it's far from what anyone would call real justice. Like, they do have their name taken away from them, which is something important to them, but they're all also still living in mansions and will be probably for the rest of their lives, I'm sure.
Yeah, but I doubt they're ever going to face real charges. I think their wealth should be completely stripped and put back into the system to try to fix it. A minute amount of the, I saw an estimate somewhere that they've done like trillions of dollars. Just, they've done a priceless amount of damage to the world. They're not wealthy enough to fix the damage they've actually done. Everything should be stripped from them.
Well, that's basically the book, right? I mean, obviously we had to skip over probably a few, like some of the court case stuff is actually like pretty sort of exciting to read. Honestly, it was like a real page turner part for me.
Yeah, it was.
Even though I kind of knew, of course, like generally how it was going to end up, but like, really good book. I guess there was a subject I had on my mind from like the beginning of all this. I think even before I started reading the book and I just watched the documentary, but like, I think about how I've said, you know, I think all drugs should be legalized. And maybe I would want to amend that to like decriminalized. And I guess what I was thinking was like, I could see someone like pointing out me being a hypocrite or something. It's like, well, why do you have a problem with what the Sacklers are doing if you think like in this sort of libertarian way, like substances should just be
the problem is legalized. They don't admit there's any danger with them.
Right. And I mean, and the thing is decriminalized and legalized doesn't necessarily mean like not regulated either. Like there's a big difference between regulation and then criminalization. I mean, essentially what I would want to see stopped is people going to jail for like possession, because that's a huge social ill, right? We've, you know, everybody knows that, at least people who would listen to us. And I started to think about like, you know, like Portugal and like how they've decriminalized like across the board and like things are like more or less, things got actually better. And then I think maybe in no way have things gotten worse, at least. Like I think I was looking at something right before today about how I think some drug use has basically gone back to the level that it was at previously. But some people think that might have something to do with like actually doing more thorough autopsies than before, or more often. But anyway, the point is like, I think there is a way, there's a world in which like we don't have to throw every like street corner like pusher or like person, like, you know, person with addiction issues or whatever into jail, and yet still
into jail.
A group like the Sacklers would be considered criminals, if that makes sense. Like, I guess what it would have to be is like personal possession, like in a fairly defined way, would be decriminalized, and then production and sales would be like extremely tightly regulated, and if you just remove the profit out of away from these substances and treat them as like almost a public utility, I guess. I don't know. I think that's a more just way to deal with a world where you're not going to like ever like rid the world of these substances. And yeah, there will be some demand for them all the time, but
I don't think users or even like people who abuse drugs should go to jail for it. Usually they're in situations where they just need help. But companies who directly try to push the product to get people to abuse it, much like the Sacklers did with OxyContin, whether or not they'll ever admit to it, they deserve some type of punishment.
Yeah, absolutely.
And ideally, we would live in a system where, especially with prescription medicine, that it was like more of a public thing, that private firms would not be involved with the production of medicine. It should just be something that is publicly held and publicly done, so that, I don't know, things like the vaccine could be distributed everywhere easily because they wouldn't have, you know, copyrights and patents on them.
Well, if there's no way to profit off of say oxycodone, there would be nothing remotely close to the opioid epidemic, I feel like.
Yeah, because they would have had no reason to advertise it. Also, drug advertising, that whole business needs to go away.
Well, I'm sure we'll be back on this topic in some way or another in the future. But it was a good first round of book club.
Yeah, I think so.
And
I feel like I learned a lot, and I already felt like I knew a lot about the subject, so I'd actually done a lot of like personal reading on it before the podcast, but I didn't realize how depraved the Sacklers were. And I'm pretty sure in some of our earlier episodes, I've even named them the most evil family in America.
Yeah. Yeah. They were somehow worse than I expected as well. Yeah. So I strongly recommend reading this book.
Yeah, I was actually going to say, I think I'm just going to keep my recommendation today to the book and documentary we've been talking about for the past 3 weeks.
Yeah. I will too. But I guess that's it for today, right?
That's it for today. Shall we say goodbye?
Yeah.
By goodbye, I mean, go check out our website at heatdeathpod.com and give us a subscribe. If you like the video, wait, this isn't the video.
Smash that bell.
If you like the radio,
turn on your record player, TV, podcast.
Tell us. You can connect with us on CB Radio.
Yes, shout at us through CB Radio, maybe an email, maybe a DM. Did you say we're on Twitter? We're on Twitter, at Heat Death Pod. All right. I gotta go to the hospital. You gotta go to work.
Yep. Okay, I'll talk to you later.
All right, see ya.
Getting older, I'm starting to eat my vegetables.